Good morning, church. Let's all be coming in, finding a seat. As we do that, we're going to jump into worship. I'm going to invite you to stand, as we always do. Hang on, I got to mute my laptop real quick. That'll make sense later. All right, let's sing out.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day. Mortals join the mighty chorus, which the morning stars began. Father, love is reigning o'er us. Brother, love binds man to man. Ever singing march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music leads us onward in the triumph song of life.
I can see the promised land, though there's pain within the plan. There is victory in the end. Your love is my battle cry. When my fears like Jericho build their walls around my soul, when my heart is overthrown, your love is my battle cry, the anthem for all my life. Every giant will fall, the mountains will move, every chain of the past you've broken into, over fear, over lies. We're singing the truth that nothing is impossible with you. There is hope within the fight, in the wars that rage inside. Though the shadows steal the light, more love is my battle cry, the anthem for all my life. Every giant will fall, the mountains will move, every chain of the past you've broken into, over fear, over lies. We're singing the truth that nothing is impossible. Every giant will fall, the mountains will move, every chain of the past you've broken into, over fear, over lies. We're singing the truth that nothing is impossible with you. No greater name, no higher name, no stronger name than Jesus. You overcame, broke every chain, forever reign, King Jesus. No greater name, no higher name, no stronger name than,
come on, church.
You overcame, broke every chain, forever reign, King Jesus. And every giant will fall, the mountains will move, every chain of the past you've broken into, over fear, over lies. We're singing the truth that nothing is impossible. And every giant will fall, the mountains will move, every chain of the past you've broken into, over fear, over lies. We're singing the truth that nothing is impossible, that nothing is impossible.
impossible, that nothing is impossible with you.
Amen, church, amen. Y'all go ahead and be seated. We have a little special portion to do this morning. We got our Lithuania team here on a Skype call, so they were watching all of y'all worship just now. It's pretty cool. That's why I had to mute my computer. But we got Seth and Matt and a few others. I don't really know their names, but I'm going to turn it over to Jeremy. He's actually coming to you live out in the lobby on his phone. And so he's going to kind of narrate it with them. And so y'all listen up.
Can you guys hear me okay?
Yes.
All right, there you go. We are unmuted. Hey, everyone, and I'm going to let Matt take it over.
Hey, Garrett. Hey, Gateway. Jeremy, what you got for us?
Well, I've had to come out here in the lobby because everyone was getting on my nerves.
Well, I've got some good news. We had a great lesson this morning. First off, at the Vilnius Church of Christ this morning, from Seth Medeiros, I think most everybody knows him, telling us that Tabitha was a great example to all of us. And then we had great singing, we had a great attendance, and then this afternoon we had great fellowship with some of the members of the church. We're about to have another great fellowship here at Yosa's new house / mansion. And then before that, the four of us are, well, the three of us from Gateway, we're going to make it back to Pensacola because we had a negative test. The fourth one is my third brother, Thomas, from Spain. He surprised us by coming in the day after we got here and has been just a joy to be with while we've been here. It's been a great trip.
That's phenomenal. They're not sharing the video. They've got a turn. Oh, so I've been told that your video is not sharing to the audience. Ryan burst into my office to tell me this. So see if video can share live. Go ahead, Becky.
Yeah, everything about our end is showing speaker. I mean, we're looking at ourselves. We're grid viewed. Our camera's on. I mean, we're staring at ourselves in the grid view. So.
Let me get a thumbs up if I. Hey, Brenda, no, I see you sitting there.
Another website. You wanted to show you.
Can you, so give me a thumbs up. Can you see Seth?
Well, what? Why would?
No, she can't see.
No.
Yeah, that's not on our end, man, because you can see us. If you can see us, our video function is obviously working.
Yeah, that's weird. Okay, so then can you hear me okay? That's good. Okay, so could you hear Matt and what he was saying? Oh, yeah, so they can hear you just fine. So you said you all got negative COVID tests, is that correct?
Yeah, but before that, we've had a great time here. And then here at the last, couple days, we got emails from Delta saying, hey, you got to have a negative test to get back in the U.S. And it'd be the same way if we were in the Bahamas, okay, and coming back from the Bahamas. But yeah. Right, I can tell you that I was glad that I was here in Vilnius visiting with Yosis, Javila, Paul, Tia, and Ella here at their house tonight, and Snoopy, their new dog. But I feel like we've got a positive report here in Vilnius, from Vilnius. Seth did a great job this morning, and it's been a great 4 to 5 to 6 days here. We visited the camp. The camp is ready to go. We had a great youth night last night with about 21 high schoolers, and Seth did his thing and entertained everybody. And you know what I mean by that. So he was a professional.
Very nice. Very nice. Well, good deal. Well, listen, here's the deal. I'm going to pray for you guys. I'm so happy to hear about your trip, and we're anxious to see you back here. But I'll have the Gateway family, if they can, to wave at you. If you can see them, just fine. Everybody wave.
Waving back.
We're waving back.
Yeah, they are waving back. So you can't see them, but I do, and they look fantastic. So I'm going to pray, and then we'll hang out. Father God, thank you so much for this mission team. I thank you, God, for Yosis, his family, the church in Vilnius. I pray, Father, that you continue to bless their efforts as they seek to reach the Lithuanian people for you. I pray, God, that you'll return them safely home to us. And I pray, Father, that they have no hiccups in their travel arrangements. I pray that fruit will come from this trip. And I pray for our worship today that it's beneficial and honoring to you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, guys. Awesome. We love you very much.
Thank you.
Love you, too.
Bye-bye. We love you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
You
bye-bye.
Next one.
Hey, Gateway. Thanks for joining us in worship. Here's some things to highlight for you. The Gateway Student Ministry Christmas is at the Mallory's House starting this afternoon at 5:30 p.m. Please see Jessica Medeiros for more details. The Marriage Ministry Christmas Party is December 17th at La Hacienda in Milton. Bring a wrapped ornament for Dirty Santa. Sign up at the Connect Center after worship to attend. Mark your calendars for February 18th and 19th for our annual Marriage Ministry Retreat. This amazing event will be held here at the building with guest speaker Buddy Bell. More details will be available very soon, so be listening out. Our Gateway Children's Christmas program and Christmas Sanctuary is this coming Sunday, December 19th at 5:30 p.m., followed by light refreshments. We will also be streaming this amazing event on Facebook, so make plans on joining us. If you'd like more information on anything happening here at Gateway, stop by the Connect Centers and talk to a team member. We hope you have a great day.
Are we on? Good morning again. We're so glad that y'all are here this morning. It's great to see all the smiling faces. And if you're visiting with us, we hope that you feel the energy and the excitement and feel welcome. We want to tell you just a little bit about Gateway. Gateway exists to love God, to love others, and then to go into a growing relationship with Jesus. There's a lot of different ways that we do that here. There's a lot of different ministries to get involved in, a lot of different activities going on. And whether you're visiting or a member, we want you to check those out and really dive deeper into being with Jesus and growing that relationship. In my pocket, I have a $100 bill. So if I said this morning, I'm going to give this away, who would like it? Who would like this? Okay, there's some... All right, that's okay. I had to rob my kid's piggy bank to get this. All right, so I'm taking this $100 bill, and I'm going to wad it up. And I still ask you, who would want this? Is there anybody that would still want this? So still people want it. So I wad up this $100 bill. I drop it down. I've got muddy shoes. And I step on it and smash it. Who would still want this? Of course you would, because it still has its value. And that's how God looks at us. No matter how stepped on, how wadded up, just how worthless we feel, God still values us the way that we are. Just what an amazing thought as we get ready to enter into our worship again this morning. But just think about that. Let that excite you. Let that motivate you. Because that's the God that we're here to serve. So what a great feeling. And at this time, I'm just going to invite you to stand, and then we'll greet one another, and then we'll continue in our worship together.
Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Christ by high is heaven adored, Christ the everlasting Lord. Late in time, behold him come, offspring of the Virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity. Pleased as man with men to dwell, Jesus our Emmanuel. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness. Life and light through all he brings, risen with healing in his wings. Mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die, born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn King.
Amen, amen. Be seated, church.
Would you pray with me? Father, we take this time this morning to come before you, humble ourselves before you and worship, God. And we ask that you would accept our offering and that you would hear our words, God, this morning, and that they would be pleasing to your ears. God, we have so many needs that we need met, and we ask that we would come to you humbly, God, and that you would hear our concerns and our prayers. And God, first and foremost, this season with all the busyness of life and the calendars getting filled up almost daily, we ask that you would just bring us a sense of peace and tranquility, God, that we would be able to remember why we even celebrate this season. God, we ask that you would make us peacemakers, God. Teach us to be more patient with our neighbors. Help us to be more forgiving of our children and our spouses, and thank you for showing us how that is done through your Son, God. We ask that you be with Jeremy and the leaders of this church as they guide us forward into the new year. Give them strength and bless them and their families as they lead us. God, help us as we center our minds on you shortly and coming together for communion. We ask that you would bless that time, and thank you for all that you do for us. In your Son's name, amen.
A lot of stuff going on this morning, but I want to just kind of calm our minds real quick before we enter into communion. So if you'll just take a moment of silence just to kind of relax your mind, kind of get into the moment. I kind of need that myself right now, so we're going to take just a minute. All right. So we're entering into communion together with each other, with those across the world in Lithuania and all across the globe, and also with our Heavenly Father. And during this season, we think about Christ. We think about the time that he came to this earth. And as this song says, faithful love from above came to earth to show the Father's love. And so he came to do that and to die for us, to raise again so that we could show the world his love as well and give everyone a chance of being with him in heaven. What a beautiful love story that is. So we're going to stand as we sing this song and another song, and then we will join in communion together.
Faithful love flowing down from the thorn-covered crown makes me whole, saves my soul, washes whiter than snow. Faithful love calms each fear, reaches down to rise each tear, holds my hand when I can't stand on my own. Faithful love from above came to earth to show the Father's love, and I'll never be the same, for I've seen faithful love face to face, and Jesus is his name. Faithful just when hope seems to end, welcome face and sweet embrace, tender touch filled with grace, faithful love, endless power, living flame, spirit's fire, burning bright in the night, guiding my way. Faithful love from above, he came to earth to show the Father's love, and I'll never be the same, for I've seen faithful love face to face, and Jesus is his name. How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb, in desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? And what heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The
The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Lift your hands.
Salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. And hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. And there's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe out of the silence. The roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me.
Then came the morning.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe out of the silence. The roaring lion declare the grave has no claim on me.
Declare it.
Jesus, yours is the victory. And hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. And death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. And there's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living host. And hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Grip on me, you have broken every chain, and there's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Can I get an amen? Be seated.
Morning, family.
Morning.
I can't say it any better than those two songs we just sang. So please join me in prayer and let's remember what an awesome gift that we've been given. Dear God, we come before you now. Just in awe and wonder at the design and the sacrifice that you and your Son, Jesus Christ, made for each and every one of us, Lord. From the beginning of time, before there was time, before any of us ever existed, and for all those who will exist, and for all of our friends and family and brothers and sisters around the world that we've already spoken to this morning. Lord, we're thankful for the design, for the suffering, for the willingness to create this present of your Son, Jesus Christ, for him being willing to see the need and to care so much about us that he's willing to become flesh, to live as a human, to love, to suffer, to struggle, to sacrifice, to lead, to teach. Also that we might be a part of your family, Lord, so that we might be your children. As we partake of this bread at this moment, which represents that fleshly body that did so much for us, that awesome present, I ask that you broaden our minds, you help us to pause and think and to understand just a little bit what went into that and how this is something that is not able to be replicated and the most priceless gift that we could ever receive. And I ask all this in your Son, Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Would you bow with me again? Father, as we consider the power of the gift and what it means for us, what it means for us as far as hope, as far as forgiveness, as far as the cleansing that we can receive, as far as the passing of the judgment that we no longer have to do, we no longer have to receive the sentence because you and your Son, Jesus Christ, loved us so much that you were willing to give us this gift, that he was willing to shed his blood that we might be covered, that we might be forgiven, that we might again become a part of your family, Lord. I ask that as we partake of this cup that we can feel a cleansing, we can feel a relief, we can feel a new life, a new power, that we can feel it today and we can feel it tomorrow and next week and throughout the rest of our lives and eternity, Lord, because this is an eternal gift. And we are so thankful for that sacrifice. Lord, we ask that you be with us and help us to, as best we can, appreciate this gift now and forever. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Throughout the Old and New Testament, God talks to us about offering, about giving back from what we've been blessed with. This is the time in our service where we choose to do that. And under the front left of each section, there's a little basket. If you will, grab it, begin passing that. You know, we've tossed around different ways to do this throughout the years. Personally, I feel like this is the most boring part of our entire worship. And it shouldn't be. So I've instructed to them to play the song Celebrate Good Times Come On while we pass it. And you laugh. One day we're going to do that. It's going to happen, and you're going to have to give anyway, whether or not you love or hate the song. You know, hate the song. I don't care. But we're going to celebrate this time because that's the spirit in which we're supposed to contribute. And so if you don't know how to give, you reach in your pocket. No, I'm kidding. There is, in your bulletin, there are instructions on various methods you can give to Gateway. And, of course, always you can give in the basket as it passes. So let's pray to God to bless this time together. Father God, as we pass these baskets, God, we are literally participating in an act of worship. I know it sometimes seems, especially this time of year, where our bank accounts have dwindled nearer to the zero mark because of our giving that we love to do as a family. Help us, God, in this moment to realize that giving to your kingdom is more important than even that moment. and help us to give with a cheerful heart. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Can't get that tune out of my head now. Well, Jeremy, it's 10:40, so you don't got much longer on your sermon with all the Skype stuff going on, so I'm going to have to be kind of brief today. I'm sorry. Everybody's going to be looking at their watch now. The title of today's sermon is The Journey. And we as Christians, we know that we are on a journey. As I was thinking about this topic, I thought popped in my head, on a journey, you're constantly moving, right? So in your Christian walk, if you're not moving, you're not on a journey. If you're staying still, if you're stagnant, as we hear it said in your faith, you're not on the journey with God. But you're on a journey, and I don't know what your journey looks like right now. Could be bright, could be joyous, could be filled with a lot of sorrow. Whatever you are going through right now, we're not alone. And we're with our Christ that came to this earth. So we sing this song, Never Once. Never once did we ever walk alone. And never once did he leave us on our own. That's what it says. Let's all stand. We're going to sing this song, and then we will...
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone, and never once did you leave us on our own. You've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never. God, you are faithful. You are faithful. God, you are faithful. Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us.
Amen, amen. Be seated.
You know, a journey takes a very long time, and so will this sermon. Because it's a journey. You know, I don't know about you, but as much as we travel, I don't like to travel. I don't. I like the destination much better than I like the in-between. I don't like flying. I don't like driving on roads, especially wet ones. And so I always dread that part of the journey. Like I said, I love the destination. We are all about the destination. You are all about the destination. There are times where you know where you're going to go and you know the fun you're going to have when you get there. You know the freedom that being away from the monotony of the normal will be enjoyable enough to the point where you dread the return. Such is the journey. Today, we're going to start off the video clip with a journey. Now, what is the video clip? The video clip is the literal journey, at least a segment of it, a portion of it, with Joseph and Mary on their way to Bethlehem for the census. I want you to understand, we'll talk more about this journey in a little bit, but it was a long journey, especially for them, especially being 9 months pregnant. But a lot of things happen on that journey that are not necessarily mentioned in Scripture. But you've traveled, you've journeyed. You could probably assume that conversation took place. You could assume what frustrations were there. And by reading the situation that they are in, you can assume what trials they were to face. So I take you to the journey of Joseph and Mary.
We might see Samuel, but it's been so long. I don't know if he's living in the same home.
Hope so. You said so much about him.
We will see. We won't have any time to look for him if he's not, of course.
You'll see.
Are we out? Not even a drop. Come on.
Joseph?
Yes?
Can you stop, please? I'd like to walk for a bit.
No, Mary. Why would you want to walk? It's dangerous.
I'm getting a bit uncomfortable. Elizabeth actually told me it's good to walk and move when I feel up to it.
We won't have any water until I get you to town. You need your rest. Oh. Let me get you more comfortable, huh?
Joseph. Joseph, you don't have to be the only one walking. Plus, we're far enough away from Nazareth. Don't have to hide my condition anymore.
Mary, this blanket is stuck. There is no way that you're comfortable.
Joseph, I'd like to walk with you. Please.
I am responsible for you, Mary. For you and...
You protect us.
Yes.
I know. I'll let you help me down.
All right. You can walk for a few minutes, huh? But please, not too far. You need to save your strength.
I actually do need you to help me down.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Sorry. Oh. Slowly, slowly. Yes. Watch the baby. Oh. Okay. Is it okay?
Yes. This feels better. Thank you. Thank you for protecting me. I don't know that I've said that yet.
We have a little ways to go yet. Let's see how tonight goes and...
I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about... before. I've been meaning to say something this whole journey and I didn't and I should have. I should have months ago.
You don't have to?
Yes, I do. You could have gotten all of the bride price back from my father.
It was never about the money.
I know it wasn't. And I know it's not polite to talk about, but no one would have blamed you.
For what?
You're divorcing me. Publicly.
Mary, I...
You could be betrothed to someone that you don't have to hide. And people wouldn't be gossiping about you. And you could go be registered without having to drag me on this donkey for 5 weeks. Joseph. You are a brave man. And you are godly. And I should have said thank you.
God told me to.
I know he did. But you had a choice.
I don't believe that I did. But I'm glad. Either way. I wouldn't change a single thing that has happened since that dream.
Neither would I.
Oh, this all seems impossible, huh?
Yes. But remember what the messenger said to me? Nothing is impossible with God.
My messenger didn't say that. That would have been nice, huh? Are you feeling better?
A bit, yes.
Okay. To move quicker. You need water, and I plan to get settled for the part where your messenger and my messenger said the same thing. And she will give birth to a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. Yes, that part. Come on.
Such a neat take on that passage. That donkey did not have airbags, so it was a little bit difficult for her. Imagine she probably was better off walking than she was riding on that donkey. But I want us to look really quick, if we can, at the scriptures that it's referencing. Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25, and then we'll look at Luke chapter 2, verses 1 through 7. So I'll read from Matthew chapter 1, beginning of verse 18.
This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. Interesting. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. Flip over, Luke chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. "In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house of the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them." You know, one thing we never really talk about is how God massively inconvenienced Joseph and Mary. It was his fault. It was his fault. Mary wasn't walking down the street one day thinking, "Boy, if only I was impregnated with the Holy Spirit." Joseph never thought in a million years when he was a youngster dreaming about who he might marry, did he think, "Man, I hope that right before I get married that she gets knocked up." Never crossed his mind. But it's exactly what happened. It was a massive inconvenience to them. And God caused it. Have you ever wrestled with that? Now, because it's this story and because it's this season, chances are you would say to me, "Well, no, I've never wrestled with that, Jeremy." Because, I mean, I doubt saying that God would inconvenience anybody is, you know, complimentary to our God. Oh, but you have. You have wrestled with being inconvenienced by God. At some point in your spiritual life, I guarantee you, you thought to yourself, "Why me, God? Why now? Why this?" And somehow you blamed God for an inconvenience that you were having to go through because we believe that God controls our fates. God controls our destiny. And so this morning, I ponder the importance of sending the Messiah into the world, knowing that it was going to massively inconvenience a righteous couple. You see, you can look at the servant Job mentioned in the Old Testament, where Satan goes to the Lord, to God, and he says, "Hey, you know what? Give me anybody." And God says, "Have you considered my servant Job? He's righteous. He'll never leave me." And Satan's like, "All right, buddy, you're on." And he goes for it. And in a similar sense, there's a righteous couple, Mary and Joseph, betrothed to be married. Engaged is another word for that. And God says, "They're a righteous couple. I'm going to lay this inconvenience on them because it is important for me to send my son into this world. I want you to consider the inconveniences." The first one is this: a virgin birth. It is difficult enough, mothers, to give birth. Am I right? But to give birth as a virgin is extremely unfair and difficult. Not only physically, but socially. I mean, she's right when she asked Joseph, you know what, you could have divorced me, and I want to thank you for not doing that. You didn't have to do that. And he says, I really had no choice. For a woman to get pregnant before she was married meant a lifetime of being outcast. It meant that you never got married. No man, unless he was unworthy of the law, would take a woman who had already had a child. It was unheard of. Women weren't exactly placed on this pinnacle of you know, respect. They were already looked down upon in their culture and kind of behind the men, and the men were over them, and they weren't educated typically. They were passed by. They were seen as the homemakers, and that was it, and that was their God-given responsibility. And God says, no, 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 I'm going to take Mary, and I believe not only is she righteous, but I believe that she can do this. And he places that inconvenience on her. The second one is this, the Judean winter. I was in Israel, in Judea, in the winter. And let me tell you, it is crazy. I was in the desert during the day where the temperature was 92 degrees. We went to Jerusalem, and 2 days later, I was standing on the Temple Mount, and it was snowing on me. What? A place less than 30 miles apart, one is almost 100 degrees, and the other has snow on it. And when it wasn't snowing, it was raining. And it was raining significantly. So much to the point where many of the guys that were on our tour had their umbrellas turned inside out. And not only was it raining, it was freezing cold. It was driving rain. And we had to walk down the Mount of Olives, which is not an easy hike, on cement during this icy rain as it's coming down, holding on to a rail. And they go through the Judean winter and on this pathway that from Nazareth to Bethlehem was 90 miles. Most scholars believe that Mary, especially being 9 months pregnant, said that she could only probably withstand about 10 miles a day, so this journey took them about 9 to 10 days. 9 to 10 days on the back of a donkey in the freezing cold at night in the desert. By the way, that's the trick about the desert, is it's 90 during the day and it's 30 at night. It plummets. And I drove in a bus. And even in the bus ride, what's amazing is how absolutely up and down the land is. You're climbing and you're descending. You're climbing and you're descending. And I'm imagining on the back of a donkey, it's not nearly as comfortable as a 40-passenger tour bus. Being soaking wet, shivering cold, and 9 months pregnant. But we don't talk about that. Matter of fact, chances are, in a couple weeks, or maybe a week, about a week, when we have our Sunday night Christmas program, the kids aren't going to be up here soaking wet, shaking as they reenact the nativity. We don't think about it. Why? Because we get these neat little, you know, postcards in the mail that show this very white Joseph and this very white Mary and this little baby in this neat little wooden, you know, trough. And he's there, and everything's wonderful, and there stands Joseph, proud dad, with a staff in hand. Almost as if he's in, you know, Pensacola Beach. This is nice. This is nice. This inn was not so bad. Most scholars believe that the inn itself would have contained not a lot of animals, but donkeys and sheep. It did not smell pretty. It did not look pretty. As a matter of fact, they probably had to shovel out what was already in there so that they could make way to spend the night. If you went to a Holiday Inn and you were met by those conditions, chances are you might go to the front desk. But not them. They endured. The third and final one is not the Judean winter, but instead, seems my advancer has died on me, so let's go forward. The Jordan River Forest. The Jordan River Forest. Go back there. The Jordan River Forest was famous. As a matter of fact, archaeologists have found pamphlets that warned of the dangers of the Jordan River Forest. What is that? Well, the Jordan River goes from north to south, from Mount Hebron all the way into the Dead Sea. And where it goes, where it travels along its journey, even in the desert, there are these oases, or there is this massive forest that it wound its way through that were present lions and bears, not tigers. I wanted to throw that in there, but just lions and bears. And they were present. So that was one of the conditions. When Mary thanks Joseph for protecting her, one of the things that he would have protected her for was the attacks of these beasts. Many times when you traveled in caravan, you looked for traders to jump in so that you would have some extra protection, because it wasn't just lions and bears that were on the way. There were marauders, pirates, people that were there that would steal, people that would kill, people that would wreak havoc on young, innocent travelers trying to make a journey, especially for a census. It was mandatory that they had to go to Bethlehem to be counted. Mandatory. Convenience? I don't think so. So let's make that practical, can we? Let's set up our own journeys. What are your inconveniences? Sicknesses? Yeah, sometimes sicknesses can be a massive inconvenience. You had plans. You had a retirement that you wanted to enjoy together, but that sickness claimed your loved one. Convenience? I don't think so. Familial inconveniences. Child still living at your house? Still 30? Living at your house? You ever had to bail one of your children out of prison? Familial inconveniences. Ever had family come to your house on Thanksgiving? Especially the ones you don't want to come to your house at Thanksgiving? How about jury duty? Never have I ever gotten a letter in the mail that said, you are up for jury duty. And I was like, yeah, I love jury duty. Doubt you have either. How about this one? An 8th Christmas party in the span of 2 weeks. Many of you are in the middle of that journey. I love Woody Allen's quote. Woody Allen's quote is this. Skipped it over. He says, if you want to make God laugh, tell him your plans. If you want to make God laugh, tell him your plans. So here's the deal. We haven't really wrestled yet with the inconvenience aspect of it. So let's go to the Philippians 2, 5 through 7 passage. It reads like this. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. Now, we always teach this angle from a point of humility when we talk about it, that Jesus is willing to sacrifice himself. But I want to make the nature of God, the very same Jesus that inconvenienced, whose birth inconvenienced Joseph and Mary. And let's look how he lived. Jesus himself was inconvenienced. Not everybody loved him. Many people wanted to kill him. Not everybody believed in him. Yet he continued to spread his message. He would be tortured. He would be crucified. He would be buried, really, as an insult to the Jews and to the Christians. So what about it? Jesus exists in the world as God, but doesn't use it to his own advantage. Matter of fact, what he does is he lowers himself to the point of a servant and washes the feet of his disciples, even when he didn't have to be. He didn't have to be a servant. He was the Lord. He was the King. He was the ruler. He was the creator of the universe. Talk about being inconvenienced. If I was the ruler of the universe, I would very much hope that those around me would revere me. They would put me at the best place at the table. They would wait on me hand and foot, that they would wash my feet, that they would do my bidding, and they would listen to my words because I'm in charge. I'm head honcho. I call the shots. But instead, they don't. And as the ruler and creator of the entire universe, I decide it's no big deal. I'll just wash their feet. Let's go to that next quote. The truth is, the only thing convenient about God's plan is that God is in it. The only thing convenient about God's plan is that God is in it. So for those of you with hopes and dreams that your life is going to turn out this way and that way, if you believe that Christianity, that Jesus coming into the world was to save your sins and give you this amazing, fruitful life, I hate to break it to you, but you're on a journey. You're on a journey. And sometimes that journey means that you are going to have to experience awful things. And you'll have to experience the awful things and not lose your faith in the awful times. And that's hard. That's extremely difficult. I don't want to be the type of person that lives my faith conditionally on how good my life is at the moment. Now, the beauty of Joseph and Mary is that when they had their dreams, when they had their angelic appearances, when they were told, this is the inconvenience that's coming on your life, they didn't seem to bat an eye. They just went along with it. That takes an incredible amount of faith. That the same God who has inconvenienced you is the same God who is with you in the midst of that journey. He's present with you. He's there with you. He's for you. He's for you. He's for me? Then why the inconvenience? Because it's part of his grand plan. You mean to tell me that my journey, the failures that I've made, the hiccups that have happened, the dreams that have not come true, the unplanned things that happened to me, you're going to tell me that that's part of God's plan? Listen, I don't understand it either. I know that the only thing promised to us in the garden at the fall of mankind was the entrance of sickness and death and decay. It meant a poison had entered into humanity that would coexist between the goodness of God and the reality of death. We are not called to be thrilled about what God allows, but rather to be obedient in the midst of his calling. Let me say that again. We are not called to be thrilled about what God allows, but rather to be obedient in the midst of his calling. Are you on a journey? Maybe right now you're in the midst of a journey. Maybe your marriage is in the midst of a journey, and right now, instead of it being on a mountaintop, experiencing bliss and everything, it is in a valley where threats are at every angle, and you're not happy, and you look at somebody else and you say, they've got what I want, and doggone it, it's your fault because I could have had it, but you entered my life, and well, we made mistakes, and here we are now, we find ourselves in this mess. Maybe it's a financial journey for you. Maybe for you, you were on your way to success and everything was going good, but you made a couple of bad investments, a couple of bad decisions. Maybe your lifestyle has been one that didn't manage finances too well, and you find yourself in a situation, and you look across the road, and you see your neighbor, and you see what they drive, and you see what they have, and you don't know their situation, but boy, don't you wish that you had the smile on the face that they have. Maybe that's your journey. Maybe you've experienced the loss of a truly loved one, and you wake up every single day missing that loved one, wishing that that had never happened, and you don't know where to turn because you wish you had more support. But the truth of the matter is, you're still in the midst of that journey. You don't wake up one morning and everything has been put back to normal. It's forever with you. It's an inconvenience. But maybe every single one of you that are sitting here right now, recognizing the fact that your journey is your own, are faithful to the God who has called you to live in this world and live for Him in this world. Now, I'll tell you, it is difficult sometimes being a Christian. Sometimes it stinks. I mean, sometimes it is, you don't know where you're going to muster the next smile because you don't feel like smiling. We've been talking about these prayer stations that we're setting up, and we're still slowly gathering people and everything to that are interested in praying with and for people. One of the reasons that we really want to do this is because we realize that in order to deal with the journey that we're on, we have to talk to God on a regular basis and include Him in the midst of the journey. Because if you go walking down the road with no provisions, eventually you're going to starve. You're going to thirst to death. So why not take the bread of life, right? And the fountain, everlasting fountain, that allows you to never thirst with you on the journey. You can't do this on your own. And so we believe that prayer is one of the things that's tantamount to living into the life that God has called us into. Let me tell you where we got this idea. Jennifer and I traveled to Orlando one Thanksgiving, and we went to a church while we were away. And in that church, they had these prayer stations set up. And they usually had people sitting in them during service. And I saw the banners that they had. It said prayer and everything. And the minister got up at the beginning, and he said, "Hey, listen, it wasn't just an ending altar call type situation." He said, "We've got these prayer banners up, and today we're going to be specific about what our needs are. And today, if you feel like your marriage is in peril, or if you just want to be a prayer of blessing over your marriage, or you've got a situation that you need prayed for, then we've got our prayer counselors at these stations, and we want you to go there and be prayed for." And I sat there, and I was like, "Nobody's going to go. Nobody's going to go." Like, I wasn't about to be like, "Jen, we got that issue. Let's go. Remember what we talked about last night? Let's go." I wasn't about to do that. The moment I grabbed her hand and we started walking is the moment I would begin to feel like every eye is on me. They all know. They all think I'm about to get a divorce. Well, I'm not. Well, how dare they judge me? That's the world we live in. Because we're on that journey. And rather than bringing God into the midst of our mess, we're too prideful to admit that we have fault. And I sat there as I saw one guy just grab his wife's hand and say, "Let's go." And she's like, "Okay." And they got up. It was right in front of us, two rows in front of us. Got up and they went over to this couple and they just got there. And we're worshiping. I mean, we're singing and they're over there praying. And I was just watching them like, maybe she's going to slap him at any moment. Maybe we're going to see. They're going to have to call 911 and have a 911 situation happen over here because they got to get involved. There's a domestic dispute about to occur here in church. It was really awkward. Then I saw another couple get up and go to another one, and then another couple get up and go to another one. And then I realized all of a sudden, wait a minute, the culture of this church is that they constantly ask the Lord to be in the midst of their journey. What would it take for you to walk to one of those? Let me ask you, I've been asking myself for 10 years, what does it take you to walk up here and meet with me? Yeah, that's it. Yeah, this is a reprimand. Okay, all right, you hear me? I'm tired of just staring at you feeling awkward. Every time I give a good sermon, I'm like, I pour my heart in the sermon, and y'all just sit there and look at me as if I didn't say anything. Every single one of y'all. And I could ask you to recite it back to me, and you know what you'd say? You'd say, "I don't know, but the Dolphins just scored." You wouldn't say that. Nobody watches the Dolphins. Anyway. Sometimes we are in the midst of a journey, and we feel lost. We feel like we're lost in this journey because we're so used to doing everything on our own, and it's no wonder we blame God when things get rough. Because we're not used to inviting Him into the midst of our very prideful life. And I'm telling you right now, as you begin next year, this year and next year, to see these tables fill up with people, we're going to put Benny and Amy Haughton in one of them, counselors. You know, that way you can kind of, you know, like horn in on the fact that they're going to pray for you, but also get some free counseling in, you know what I'm saying? They're like, yeah, could you pray for us because he thinks I snore too much. You know, I don't know. I don't know, whatever you'll go to. And we put Kelly and Ryan will be over here today. You know that, Kelly, you're going to be over there. They're going to be over here. And if you just want to receive prayer for whatever, it doesn't matter. We'll have an elder and his wife in this prayer room back here for privacy. If you just want to go and you want to pray, if you want to cry, that's the room to go to. You can cry out here and be more of a man than you've ever been, men. Right here. We talk about the fact that we as men have to step up and we have to lead and we have to do all this stuff. But if we're not willing to step over the toxic things that sell us to what manhood is and be vulnerable enough to lead for God in front of our families, you're never going to know what it feels like to be a man. Never. Joseph did the unthinkable by not divorcing his wife who was pregnant. And everybody in town knew it. And he said, I'm going to do it anyway. And you saw it in Scripture. He was going to divorce her. And he fell asleep one night, and the Lord was like, guess what? It wasn't somebody else. It was me. I often wondered if he was like, well, why'd you do that? The truth is, every single one of us has a journey. And this morning, if you need prayers for your journey, please don't let pride get in your way. Respond to the invitation as we stand and while we sing.
Had it not been the Lord who was on our side, had it not been the Lord who was on our side, the anger of the enemy would have swallowed us alive. Had it not been the Lord who was on our side. Blessed be the Lord who would not give us up. Blessed be the Lord for his unfailing love. The snare is broken and we have escaped.
Blessed be the Lord.
the church say, amen. Amen. Be seated.
So a homework assignment for you is next week I get to preach my favorite sermon that I preach typically every year, and it's going to be solid. I love it. It's one of my favorite stories of two amazing characters in the New Testament around the birth of Jesus, or at least the childhood of Jesus, and that is of Simeon and Anna. And so look that up, read about it, because we're going to talk about it maybe in a new light for you. I'm really excited about that. Three have come forward today to request prayer, and well, two request prayer and one prayer of thanks. David, Megan, and Wyatt. Little Wyatt, you know, had an emergency this past week and was in the hospital for a procedure, and that procedure turned out to be extremely important, and it went well. So they write, Gateway family, thank you so much for prayers for Wyatt's health and David's safe return this week. Your text and prayers were so appreciated in providing and provided peace during a very scary time. We're thankful for you. Chris Kerb writes, request prayers for his stepson, Matthew Curtis. He checked into Baptist Hospital with an infection in his foot from diabetes, and they are asking for prayers for him. And then Deanna Overson writes that her sister, Judy Barber, has been diagnosed with cancer. This is her fourth time going through this awful, awful journey. And doctors say that it is treatable. That's good news. But she is obviously saying, why me? And so we, knowing, even just based on this sermon, we can understand why people say that. So this is the time for you guys to love on her and showcase your faith in a very, very positive way for her. And so we'll definitely be remembering those and sending those out on the email for our prayer warriors to be engaging in those throughout the week. So at this time, one of our elders, I think it's Mike, Mr. Mike, Mike's going to come up, and he's going to dismiss us in prayer. Thank you so much, and I hope you have a blessed week.
After I finally surrendered to the fact that I needed prescription glasses, I got some, and they helped me to see pretty well, except for the glare of night driving and too low incident light for me to be able to read carefully. But a recent eye examination said that it was time for me to get rid of cataracts. I had that operation on Thursday, and immediately, what a difference! I am now seeing things in a new light and with clarity that's intense, far beyond my expectations, and my biggest thrill is that I can look through my telescope and see stars that are circular or spherical instead of square. In a similar vein, as we planned and developed our new Gateway facility over the last 3 years, we prayed that God would show us how he would have us use it, how he would have us employ it in a way that it would give service to our community and give growth to his kingdom. But as the project neared completion, because of the enthusiasm of the body, all you who came up with ideas about what we could do to serve others, and from organizations approaching us to see if they could team with us in order to serve both God directly and the community, our eyes have been opened to a number of new possibilities far beyond what we expected. And I just say all that because I want you to know that we're really excited in the leadership of the church and overjoyed, and we will be revealing these new initiatives to you over the next few weeks. Right now, if you'd go to the Father with me, please. Father God, our gratitude for your gift of this new facility is limitless, and we just ask that your Spirit might continue to assist us in selecting and prioritizing those ministries which you would have us pursue in the new year. Father, this morning we ask that you be with those souls who are affected by the massive tornado going through the Midwest of our country. We ask them that you raise up those who are wounded, raise up those souls whose family members have been killed, and raise up those who have lost hope because of loss of material possessions. And as we here in Pensacola celebrate your greatest gift, your son. Embolden us to show our faith in him to all we meet. And it's through him we pray. Amen.